if we wanted to fly into space, we could either try to become astronauts, like, haha, good luck, it's probably not gonna happen. You could also wait until maybe Virgin Galactic finishes their project. That's gonna take a long time, but wouldn't it be much more fun if you just created your own spacecraft yourself, your own space rocket, fly into space doing that? Working metal doesn't sound very sexy, but it's actually one of the best skills that I've obtained through life, except sketching and drawing. I mean, creating anything in metal is just, there's no limits to what you can actually do if you have an idea. And of course, wood is nice, but you're not gonna go far in a space rocket made of wood. Yeah, my name is Christian van Bengtsson. I'm a co-founder of Copenhagen Suborbitals, a non-profit and open-sourced DIY space program. We're not doing orbital spaceflight at the moment. We're not aiming for it right now. We're doing suborbital spaceflight. It's a parabolic flight where you go up and down a short trip. Copenhagen Suborbitals was founded in 2008 by myself and my partner, Peter Madsen. I was back in Denmark after I've been working at NASA Johnson Space Center. And at that time, I read an article that Peter was launching his first and last submarine, Nautilus. And in that article, I read that Peter had a prior history doing rocket engines, and he wanted to work again with rocket engines. So I thought to myself, let me talk to Peter. And I contacted him, and we met in his submarine. And basically, within a few hours, we decided to join forces. He would be creating the launch vehicles, I would be creating the space capsules. And from that moment, actually, Copenhagen Suborbitals was founded.
My name is Peter Madsen. I'm with Copenhagen Suborbitals. My part of it is the rocket engines that propel the spacecraft. And it's also the construction of launch pads and all the systems essentially that takes the spacecraft from planet Earth and into space. Well, I'm not obsessed. Not at all. It's all the other people who are obsessed with footballs and that sort of thing. I'm just doing what I've always been doing. I'm playing. This is the TM65 rocket engine. It uses two components for its propellants. The one is liquid oxygen, and the other is alcohol, the same type of alcohol that we drink, but this is just slightly more concentrated. So it's a Schnaps Lux engine. This engine really works the same way as the engines that originally propelled the Saturn V rocket to the moon. It's the same type of technology. The difference from the space shuttle main engines to this one is that while a shuttle engine consists of literally tens of thousands of components, this one is a couple of hundred components. All the parts that this engine is consisting of, primarily the valves, the actuator, the nuts and bolts, the tubes and pipes and everything, are all the products of modern industry, and they're all off-the-shelf things. If it wasn't used in this rocket engine, very likely this component would have found its way into an ordinary house for heating purposes. Or the water mains used in a kitchen. It's the sort of things that are completely normal that we put together and turn into a rocket engine.
using off-the-shelf products that you can buy in vast numbers are actually very reliable systems. Instead of trying to invent our own valve, for instance, why not buy one that's been produced maybe a million times? When you're working a DIY project, the natural premises is that you don't have much. You don't have much money, funding, you don't have maybe all the technology like the pro guys or the materials, and then you have to come up with solutions. And that sparks a lot of new technology, new ideas. And sometimes it also takes the solution that you would normally do very expensive, very complex in the professional world, and bring it down to a level and show people that it's actually possible to do the same, come up with the same solution for less money. The first rocket we tried to launch, it contained a hairdryer to keeping one of the valves, you know, heated up so it wouldn't freeze up. It was actually a great solution.
We have left the workshop now, and we have walked about 100 meters to one of the two test stands. And what we have is a steel gantry, and up there, there are room for the four bolts that keep, the four 16 millimeter bolts that keep the engine in place. And we have a crane that we use to hoist it up there. And on top of this steel structure, we have the propellant tanks of totally 700 kilos of propellant that the engine consumes in about 15 seconds.
Launching rockets is actually like anything else we're doing here. It's a test of different systems. We have to prove to ourselves that we are capable of handling different technologies. There's always certain things we are testing on. So it's all a part of the big puzzle ending up for a big rocket with a capsule on top. And of course, we're going to do more launches. We are aiming for a manned mission, but of course, we are only flying the big rockets with a crash test dummy inside. We're not going to be flying any persons, any live human being, until we believe that it's fairly safe. This is our space capsule, beautiful Betty, and it's the first prototype of this kind of capsule type space vehicle for one person. Most of this, the capsule I welded myself, but I did design and some of the interior welding I did with a guy called Klaus. He's my partner in doing these capsules here, and we also together developing the new capsule. And it was tested about 2 months ago. It got pretty roughed up, but it's still here, and we can still do a lot of tests, and it's a foundation of all the new capsules we're going to do in the future. Well, Randy, the crash test dummy, was inside this capsule, and well, he lost a leg. It's possible, actually, that he would have survived, only because of the direction that it hit water. So, but he might be in a wheelchair forever if it was a live person. Randy has been a good friend of ours. He's been flying for the last 2 years. So every time we have a capsule or a spaceship, he's gonna be in the seat and he's gonna take the beating. That's why you have a crash test dummy. Keeping one person alive, even only for 15-minute rides, is a big challenge. You need to create a reliable piece of confined room, confined space for one person, where you have a small seat, where you're comfortable, but also work with all the acceleration from launching the rocket, but also when landing on sea. This is where you're gonna be, and this is where you're actually gonna experience this incredible ride, where you're gonna feel the rocket lifting you away from Earth. And it's gonna be so fast, and eventually you're gonna see Earth turning around out here, and it's just an amazing feeling, actually, just to have those thoughts. When the US, they launched the first astronaut, Alan Shepard, the whole countdown actually stopped because the engineers suddenly became scared. They realized they had a person inside, and they weren't really prepared mentally for that. So the countdown stopped until Alan Shepard, he told them, light the candle. His famous words.
All right, lift off and the clock has started.
An organization like this, I don't know what's going to happen when everybody had a part in it, and they suddenly understand that this, what they did, if it doesn't work, it could have a fatal outcome. So, or maybe it's not going to be a problem. Maybe everybody's just going to find it exhilarating.
It doesn't take much courage to climb on board a rocket and have the hatch sealed and somebody light it, because it either works or it doesn't work. And if it doesn't work, the period of time you'd have to realize that is usually very short. But it takes a lot of courage. It takes an unimaginable amount of courage to be the ground crew, to be the commanders on the ground, to take the to make the decision, let's launch this thing and see if it works. And Christian is one of the few people that I've ever met who is courageous enough to do such a thing.
T-minus 10, 9, 8, 7, 6, 5, we're both ready to start.
Human spaceflight has always had this holy grail kind of sphere around it. It's supposed to be expensive, it's supposed to be very complex, so you just completely just forget the notion or the idea, let's try and build our own space rocket. People just don't want to touch it. But I hope we can inspire people that space rocket, you can actually build it yourself. If there should be some kind of legacy from what we are doing here on this DIY project, that should be showing the world that human spaceflight can actually be done on a completely different scale and on a completely different level with very simple technology. You're welcome to come and join us. You're also welcome to come here with a measuring tape and your camera. Take all the pictures, or download all of the images and sketches from our blog, and just, you know, copy the work or go from there, from what we're doing. Basically, everybody can do this if they want to do it.